A common factor for a lot of video games is the fact that you have to deal damage. And there are many different ways to make systems for receiving damage and tracing for actors to actually damage. But what is most important here is the fact that the system is consistent and always works. And if we look at Overwatch, for example, we see many different examples of how to do this. For example, McCree's hitscan, or Pharah's rockets, or even Torbjorn's bolts, or what's it called? That all have different ways that they need to trace for the targets that they actually hit. So if we start out simple, we can just make a simple system where we use three different actors. A cube that can shoot a projectile, a sphere that is the projectile, and a plane that we can actually hit. So the first system here, we will try to build it using a overlap function. So we will set the collision of the sphere or the plane here to a full overlap if you go into the collision settings. And once it's being overlapped by any actor, it will send out a message using the print function as we see here. We'll simply just type in something like overlapped or something. So we can clearly see that it has received this. So this is an example using the overlap feature and actually the downfalls of using something like this. So the projectile here is simply a sphere with the projectile movement component. We'll just add a quick material here. And then we will go into the collision settings and apply a overlap setting as with the plane. In the projectile movement, we will start out by removing the gravity and we will set the initial speed to, let's say, 1000. And the max speed will set to some arbitrary high number that we know we'll never receive. We'll never set the speed that high. Okay, so far so good. We also have to keep an eye out for the local velocity. Okay, opening up the spawner cube that will actually shoot out this projectile we just made quickly. We will just start out by making a loop as soon as the game begins. And once this starts, we'll just start a timer, and once this timer finishes, it will shoot a projectile. So you'll use the timeline here. We set the length to something like 2.5. And then we will set this custom event that says repeat the shot. I will show you how to use it once we get to the end of this function. Once the loop is finished here, or the timer is finished, we will spawn an actor. And in this case, it is the projectile of the actor. And this projectile is the one we just made. Here I just called it BP projectile. And we'll then use just the actual location and the actual rotation to point the direction of the projectile. As it uses this local velocity, the projectile will always go in the direction the actor is facing at the moment. There are many systems for this, but this is not what this video is mainly focused on, but mainly the actually tracing and registering the impact. So here we can set the local velocity, and since we had it ticked on in the earlier one, we can very easily set it. So you simply just put in a value in the X component, which will be the velocity. You can see the difference here. If we have it in global space, we have to define the Z and X, and if we have it in local space, we can simply define the X. We just put it to something like 1000, but we can quickly change it in the game here if you tick on this eye. Once this function finishes, we need to repeat the shot again, as we made the custom event, so we just call it here, repeat shot. And then we click compile. Okay, now we'll just quickly set up this system here, where we have our cube that can shoot the projectile and the plane that needs to receive the damage. So right now the projectiles are moving quite slowly, so it's easy for the computer to register that this actually happens. You can see it says overlapped, which is a success in this case. But if we just take a moment and then let's set the projectile speed to something a bit higher, let's say 2000, and see what happens. Okay, still perfect overlap, not really an issue in any way here. But if we set it to 10,000, as you see there, it didn't register the first hit, it did register there, registers again, doesn't register there. And the reason for this is that the first tick and the second tick, there's no overlap with the actual face. And the cases where it is, it will register. So only in some cases. So we will actually do a trick, as shown here, later on. But first we need to know how to do these checks. And we actually use this line trace, which is the same as McCree's hit scan uses. So to make a hit scan, it is actually quite simple. We'll make the exact same setup as before, but this time we won't need a projectile because we will just use a simple trace to check if we have hit our target. So we set up our target again, and this time we will not use a overlap mechanic. We'll check that it is being damaged. So you go into the cell, you check it if it can be damaged, and then we go in here and says in event any damage. Then it has to pop out a message that say, I don't know, ouch, I took damage, or I don't know, something like that. Just to be safe and sure that it has actually registered this. So the good thing about the any damage is that we don't have to check for overlaps or anything. We only have to check whether or not this has been damaged. And this makes it also a lot more versatile in how we damage it, because we can actually choose the way we damage it ourselves. Okay, now we make a shooter, and this time it is, you can imagine this is the character McCree, for example, and we simply just give him a damage function. So again, we make a loop, and we make a repeat shot function, just as before. The loop, we set the timer to, let's say, 2.5, and yeah, that's fine. Okay, so once the loop finishes, one run, we will do a line trace. And a line trace, in this case by channel, will check anything that fits with this trace. And it is by default set to visibility, so anything that blocks visibility will be targeted. This is actually perfect because, yeah, something like a plane or, yeah, pretty much any massive or solid you have inside Unreal will be registered as visibility. You can go more into these channel traces in another video, but for now it is just this visibility will most likely be registered by all default primitive objects. Okay, so the start is just the actor location, but the end of the trace we need to define as well. In this case, we will do it at a point 10,000 units away from where the actor is. So we'll use the rotate vector and we'll use the actor rotation. So we will point in the direction the actor is facing 10,000 units. And this is pretty much a local space input, just with the like the velocity for the other. But we need to add it, the initial location, which is the actor location. So once we plug that into the end, we will see a simple, when you line trace, you can do these debug lines where you can see how the line is traced, which is pretty useful in this case also, so you can visualize exactly what we're doing. In case we hit something, we want to damage it. So here we say, in case we hit something, we want to, if we hit something, then the branch says it's true. And in case it's true, we need to apply this damage. So we pull the true into that, put in some arbitrary value here. And so now the actor is damaged, and we need to repeat the function as well. What we do here, repeat shot, the call that we had in the beginning. So now this should shoot, no problem. You can see here, it traces a line, and once it hit, it says, ouch, I took damage. So this is perfect. This is actually a simple hit scan. This has been used widely also in games like Counter-Strike and stuff like that. But what if we have a shot that actually flies through the air and that just hits instantly, like Torbjörn's shot or Hanzo's arrow or something like that? That is a little more tricky. Here we need to apply this system again, where we trace between the location we had before and the location the projectile has now, and then check every space in between so we don't miss a tick. So this is done entirely within the projectile, so we make a projectile again, same settings as before, nothing crazy there. But once the projectile is spawned, it should start checking this direction. And event begin play is actually a function that not only triggers when you press play on the button, but as soon as an object is spawned within the world, it will trigger whatever the event begin play says. Okay, so we make a new variable and we make it a vector and we call the former location. So this is the location it had in the former check. And once it spawns, we need to update the location the first time so it's not set to 0, 0, 0. So whenever it spawns, we will get the first location that you put it. Okay, now we can start with the timeline. So this timeline will not do any every time the timeline is finished, but every time it updates. So this is the faster your computer updates, the more the shorter these traces in between every location will be. So we do a line trace just as before, and in the start location, it will be the former check, or the former location of the projectile, and the next one will be the current location of the projectile, which is the location of the actor. You plug that in, and now we'll do a visualization of the debug lines as well, just so, yeah, to visualize what is actually happening. We'll set it to something lower this time, I don't know, like 0.4 or something. Just not a too high number, so we can actually see how the line traces in between each step. And again, if we hit something, we want to apply some damage. And yeah, in the outbreak result, we can get the actual actor that we hit just by pulling out here, and we can apply the damage. And we'll again set it to some arbitrary number like 10, for example, and then we'll plug the true factor into this, and we will need to, and if it's true, then we need to apply some damage. One more thing we need to do is actually to update the location, the former location now, to the current one, so the next time this triggers, it will have the current location from the former check. So yeah, and we do this just by simply setting the former location to the current location now, and then this will run again on the next check as it updates. Remember to set the timeline to looping, or it will only do this for 5 seconds. One more thing that's important here is you can see we don't have anything in the false statement, but we actually need to update the location even if it doesn't hit anything, just to be, or it will keep referencing a wrong point in the space. So simply just drag out here, as usual. Now this function should be good to go, and we can actually now completely overcome the issue that I showed at the beginning, since we can trace in between ticks. So even though there is a space which is not covered by the overlap, it will be registered here by the trace function. Now I'm just setting the shooter to actually shoot this this new projectile that makes these checks in between. So this is a system that can be used for arrows or anything that actually has a physical form that is moving through space as a projectile. And at very high speeds, there will be a need to do something like this. Okay, so that is pretty good. And we can try turning up the speed quite a bit to be to really show how efficient this is. You can see very, very fast projectile, still registering, no issue at all. But right now, our trace is just a small, infinitely slim line through space. But what if we have something like a missile, as we know from Farah or something like that? Then we'll need to make the line a little thicker. And here, there is actually, instead of using a line trace, we can use another type of trace. And this is called a sphere trace. This will apply a spherical trace along the path instead of a simple line, and is great for something like a missile. We can just substitute the line trace that we had before with this function instead, and you just have to put in some radius depending on how thick your missile is. Let's say it's, I don't know, 100 or something like that. We'll do the duration here as well, just to be sure. So the radius here is the thickness, as I said, and we'll just set that to 100. You can set it to whatever that fits with the missile that you're doing. Okay, and we also need to update our shooter so it actually shoots this projectile with the thickness in it, or the spherical trace. But this is pretty much how you would do something like a missile in a game, and use it however you please. In that way, and you can see it function here, but there will most likely be an issue. As you can see, it registers the impact too many times here. So the smart way to solve this is that the line traces has this access to ignore function already implemented. So you simply just promote that to a variable, and then we save the exit that we actually hit in this actor to ignore. So at the next tick, it will not register this actor. It will ignore him as per the function. So you simply just take this access to ignore, and then you drag out from it and type add. So you will add this actor to the array of access to ignore. Then you drag in the actor, and yeah, just drag in the function so it actually runs. Yes, and we compile this, and it should be good to go. Perfect. And this is how you would make something like a missile projectile in a game. So there are actually also other uses for something like this. Let's say we have a fighting system with swords. You can do a sword, and here I have applied 4 hit markers to it. Using the exact same principle, just with a line trace in this case, you'll see that this actually is a very good way to register whether or not a sword has hit something, instead of using the overlap. This is also way more consistent, and you can very easily put this into anything, and with only these 4 dots, you can make a fighting system like this that applies to all your animation, and you actually pretty much only have to focus on how the combat looks after making such a system. I really think that this is the way to go when making damage system and tracing in Unreal. I would like to hear if you have any other ways that is even better, or there's something I have missed. If you liked it, leave a like, and I hope you can use it for something.